Hallelujah. How's everybody tonight? Are you blessed and highly favored? Or are you miserable? Are you miserable and bound? Or are you blessed and highly favored? Oh, yes. Praise God. The joy of the Lord is our strength. And in His presence is fullness of joy. But you know what? You got to get to His presence. His presence doesn't come to you. You go to His presence. That means you got to fight to get to His presence. Amen? There's no victory without a battle. You got to fight. You got to fight for your healing. You got to fight for your freedom. You got to fight. That's what Jesus came to do, right? He came to fight. No wimps in the kingdom. Warriors. Amen. We are warriors. Turn to your neighbor and say, you're a warrior. You're the righteousness of God. Whether you believe it or not. Hallelujah. Would you turn to 2 Timothy chapter 3? I don't feel righteous. No one asked you how you felt. If you're looking for a feeling, you're in the wrong place. How many of y'all want truth? Truth supersedes feelings. Amen? I feel good. Yeah, I feel good went to jail. When I wanted to feel good out in the world, I went to jail. Why? Because I was seeking to feel good. Now I feel wonderful. Constantly. It doesn't cost any money. It just costs something else. It's called the price to deny yourself. That price is called cooperation. Without cooperation, you don't get nothing. Amen. Jesus came to show us not only the way, amen. He came to bring us the truth. And He came to establish a position for me and you. And it's a spiritual position, but you must get in position to receive all the things of God. And that's what the Word of God is. And this is a covenant book. It's the directions. Without reading the Word of God, how do you expect to make it home? The devil will kick your butt and deceive you constantly. You'll go by every wind of doctrine. You'll go by how you feel and what people say. You'll listen to every voice of a stranger and every voice of hell that comes out. And you'll stay in that cycle because Satan's greatest weapon is deception and his power is fear. His purpose is to get you in a place of fear. Then you get into anxiety, anxiousness, and then he gets you to move out of the will of God and God's timing. Because God said something. He said, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. He really actually meant lack of understanding. Because many people can't interpret the Word. And the Word is only interpreted by the Holy Spirit. So if you try to interpret yourself, you'll be deceived. Even Jesus said, you seek the Word for salvation, but you won't come to me and get it. Because only through the Spirit can you have understanding? Only. Has everybody got it? Oh, hallelujah. 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 1. Let's speak it together. But know this, that in the last days, perilous times will come. Are we in the last days? Amen. Oh, you bet. Look at what's going on in the world. It's the days of Noah and Sodom and Gomorrah. Look around. Not in here, but look around out there. Come on, you got guys dressing like girls, girls dressing like guys, and some of them don't even know what the heck they are. Hello? You got all kinds of stuff going out there. It says, verse 2, for what? Men will be lovers, what, of themselves. Lovers of money, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, unloving, unforgiving, slanderers, without self-control, brutal, despisers of good, traitors, headstrong, haughty, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God. This is how you search yourself. Are you a lover of God more than lover of pleasures? Because if you're not, then you're lost. You're lost, L-O-S-T, living outside of salvation's truth. That means you ain't going home. But I accepted Jesus 20 years ago. Well, where you are now? Remember, who you serve when you die is where you go. Amen? Even if you accepted Jesus 20 years ago, it's what you do with your last breath, where you stand before God. And your name either gets blotted out or stays in. Verse 5, what do they have? Having a form of what? Godliness, but denying its power. And from such people do what? Turn away. Don't associate. Let God deal with them. For this sort are those who creep into households and make captives of gullible men and women, loaded down with sins and led away with various what? Lusts. They're always learning. In other words, they're always seeking knowledge. And they go to all kinds of places to seek knowledge. But they're never able to come to the knowledge of the truth, because they reject the truth, thinking that they know more or better than the truth, because they have a form of godliness. They become religious in their own state of being. But that religion is not relationship. Now, as Jannes and Jairus resisted Moses, so these also resist the truth. Men of what? Corrupt minds, disapprove concerning the faith. But they will progress no further, for their folly will be manifested to all, as theirs also was. But you have carefully followed my doctrine, manner of life, purpose, faith, long-suffering, love, and perseverance, persecutions, afflictions, which happened to me at Antioch, Iconium, and Lystra, which persecutions I endured, and out of them all, the Lord did what? Delivered me. That's relationship. Yes, and all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will what? They will suffer persecution. But evil men and imposters will what? Grow worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived, because this is where we are right now. But you must continue. Everyone say continue. In the things which you have learned and been assured of, knowing from whom you have learned them, and that from childhood you have known the Holy Scriptures, which is what? Able to make you wise or discern for what? Salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. We see now that there is a form of godliness, but they deny the power of Christ. They're always learning. They're always seeking knowledge, but never in the right places. And it's not the knowledge of God. Not the true knowledge of God. They have corrupted. Why? Because this knowledge that they seek have corrupted their minds. It's false. And when we got false news on TV, right? And the Lord said, many will come in my name. They'll have a form of godliness. I mean, the media is phenomenally false. People are listening to the media. It's incredible. They need to discern what's going on by the word of God to back up what's going on out of their mouths and search things out themselves. We are in a time and season where there's great corruption, but we're also in a time and season where it's going to be exposed even more and more and more. And evil is going to begin to climax more and more, but righteousness will climax also. Believe it or not, righteousness is going to rule. It'll be for a period of time, and then we'll be removed. Soon. Corrupted their minds by worldly influence, nullifying the walk of faith because of corruption. That's a corrupt belief system. They cannot mature in the spirit of Christ until there's a place they come to where they finally let go and let God. Sometimes you got to hit the wall of reality. You can either hit it hard or soft. But if you're really a person that's want to seek the truth, you're going to hit it. Amen? Amen? Or it's going to hit you. And it's going to slow you up, cause you to lay down. Because he loves you. Because he knows there's a difference between eternal separation and separation temporary. So it says here that because these individuals cannot abide in the truth, it talks about evil will increase, imposters will increase, deception will increase. They'll be proclaiming something. Their will of wickedness will increase. Their desires of wickedness will increase. They'll be proclaiming their free will rights. Free will rights. These are free will rights of entitlements, but not fruits of righteousness. See, there's a battle going on between rights and righteousness. Does everybody get this? There's a battle going on right now between the rights and righteousness. Even when you get arrested, what does the police officer say? You have a right to remain silent. Oh, we'll accept that donation. What does he say that when you get arrested? I mean, everybody, some of us know it by heart, but yeah, you ain't got to tell me, I know. Come on, give me those bracelets. You get free jewelry, chauffeured all the way to the palace. Get a uniform, hallelujah. And then you get fed and showered and praise God, and you get to hang around with other people that have been through college. Criminal college. You have a right to remain silent. And any word that comes out of your mouth will be used against you in the court of law. You have a right for an attorney. If you can't afford one, one will be provided for you. Well, let me tell you something. We have an attorney that's provided for me and you. His name is Jesus. Believe me, I walked out of a courtroom on a mandatory minimum 4-year prison term when Jesus was my attorney. I had a mandatory 4-year prison term to do. Had to. Mandatory. No way out. Lord said, I'll be your attorney. I walked out of that courtroom. I ended up doing 2 years of probation. I didn't care about doing probation. I was saved, filled with the Holy Ghost. I didn't plan on doing anything wrong again because I was brand new. I wanted to tell the judge it wasn't me that did it. It wasn't me, I'm telling you. Yeah, same fingerprints. I know I was on camera, but it wasn't me. It really wasn't me. So there's a fight. See, there are areas where people are fighting for their rights, but they're not fighting for righteousness. And your rights are not going to get you into heaven. Only righteousness gets you home. Go to 1 Corinthians 6. So we don't want to get caught up in this arena of fighting for rights. We want to maintain the fight for righteousness. Not that you don't have rights. In fact, you have the right. I got attacked by a bunch of individuals in a park one day because I was sharing stuff, giving out food to people and sharing salvation testimony and stuff. And the ranger come up to me and says, man, you can't do that. This is a public park. I said, right. He said, I'm going to call the police. I said, go ahead. So he went to call the police. And all the people around, it was during Easter. And man, we were handing out all kinds of candy to everyone, to all the kids, and we were having a great time. And everybody stood up for what was right, but actually they were standing up for what was righteous. And the sheriff came, and the dude shows up with this piece of paper all rolled up, doing this, slapping it against his hand like he had something. I know he didn't have nothing, because my father owns the park anyways. And the officer says, are you the one that's doing this? Yeah, I said, yes. He says, you know this is a public park? I said, yes. And I said, you ought to know better anyways. And he didn't say too much. He looked at the dude and said, I can't do nothing. And the guy said, yeah, well, you need to fill out an application next time. I said, yeah, I got your application. It's right in the garbage. And we continued to hand out, and everybody had a great time. And when the officer and the parks security left, everybody just praised God and was just happy and joyful. Because, see, I knew my rights, but my rights were backed up by righteousness. Does everybody understand it? It wasn't backed up because I was trying to get away with something. It was backed up because there was something that was righteous that was going on. And everything we were handing out, gallons of apple juice and all kinds of stuff, and we had labels on them, salvation prayers on there, phone numbers for prayer line. And people were loving it. It was a great day. It was a victorious day. But, you know, they're going to try to challenge you. But, yeah, you need to know your rights, but you stand for your rights because it's backed by righteousness, not by manipulation. Amen? 1 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 1. Speak it with me. Dare any of you, having a matter against another, go to the law before the unrighteous and not before the what? Saints. Do you not know that the saints will judge the world? Hello? Who's going to judge the world? The saints. And if the world be judged by you, are you unworthy to judge the smallest matters? Do you not know that we shall judge angels? How much more things that pertain to this life? If then you have judgments concerning things pertaining to this life, do you appoint those who are least esteemed by the church to judge? I say this to your shame. It is so that there is not a wise man among you, not even one who will be able to judge between his brother. But brother goes to law against brother, and that before unbelievers. Now, therefore, it is already an utter failure for you that you go to law against one another. In other words, you're going to court. Under what? The unrighteous court. Not before God. It's the worldly court. Because there's not righteousness in it. It's rights in it. Has everybody got it? Oh, hallelujah. So he says, now therefore it is already an utter failure for you that you go to the law against one another. Why do you not rather accept wrong? Why do you not rather let yourselves be cheated? No, you yourselves do wrong and cheat, and you do these things to your brethren. Do you not know that unrighteousness will not inherit the kingdom of God? Wow. So if you're practicing lawlessness and fruits of unrighteousness, are you able to get into heaven? No. Plain and simple. Do not be what? Deceived. Don't be what? Deceived. Don't be deceived. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor homosexuals, nor sodomites, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revelries, nor extortioners will inherit the kingdom of God. Now, that's phenomenal. What is he saying? Those who practice lawlessness or unrighteousness will not make it home. They won't make it home. In fact, in the book of Galatians, it talks about sorcery, which is associated with drugs, alcohol, drunkards. They will not make it home. So when a person overdoses, where do you think they go? I wouldn't want to tell someone you're going to go home if you overdose, because that's not true. But God knows the last thing that happens to that person. Amen? I sure hope that person somehow cries out to God for help. Or they're going to wake up in a place not so nice. He says in verse 11, and such were some of you, but you were washed. So he's saying, yes, there have been homosexuals, lesbians, transgenders, addicted, fornicators, liars. We've all come from those places. Every one of us. He says something powerful, though. He says, but you know, do you not know that? He says this, and such were some of you, but you were what? Washed. But you were what? Sanctified. But you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. In other words, there is freedom, there is deliverance, there is healing. Why? Because these are influenced by demonic forces called demons, unclean spirits, or evil spirits. That's what influences a person. And when that person agrees with what they're hearing or saying or touching, that spirit will answer that person. It doesn't, look it, people are not bad, they're deceived. Amen? They're deceived. People do bad things because they're deceived. But God loves them no matter what. But it's our responsibility to bring the light and the truth to the world, not to compromise it. You know, I'm going to share something very strange. There are no friends in the kingdom of God. There's brothers and sisters. Jesus called Judas a friend. Now, don't get me wrong. We have friends in the kingdom of God. But these friends in the kingdom of God are our brothers and sisters. Why? Because they do the will of God. Anyone that doesn't do the will of God will turn on you. It's just a matter of time. And when you try to share something with them, they'll accuse you. That's when it's time to depart and let God deal with them. You pray for them. You pray for them. You be an example to them. But you know what happens? They'll end up calling you. Because they'll know who to call when there's trouble. That's the opportunity. Sometimes you just got to wait. You just got to wait till it comes. But in the meantime, you pray for them. But see, when you begin to associate with them, then they have a mindset, because the mind is corrupt. What they're thinking is you're approving of what they're doing. And the word tells me and you that if we approve of what somebody's doing, the way they're living, we'd be judged according to it. So you're going to be judged according to what you approve also. Not only will you be judged by your intentions, but you're going to be judged by what you approve. See, that's one of the parts of suffering, is being a believer and being right with God. You're going to finally have to come to a place where you got to start cutting loose of people, places, things. You're going to have to start cutting loose of things. Why? Because you want to let go and let God. I mean, compared to eternal life, this is like a one-night sleep. For the amount of time we spend on this earth, one day we're going to wake up from this realm. And it'll be like a one-night sleep. It'll be like a dream. For some people, it'll be a nightmare. But I can tell you there's not one unbeliever in hell. Everyone that's there now is a believer. But it's too late. Hallelujah. And I want to read 11 again. Would you read it with me? And such were some of us, but you were washed, but you were sanctified, but you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. Now look at this. All things are lawful for me, but not all things are what? Helpful. In other words, there are things that are right because of my rights. But just because it's my right to do something doesn't mean it's righteousness before God. I can go down to the bar. It's my right to go down to the bar and party. It's my right to fornicate. And according to the world, does everybody understand it? It's a woman's right to have an abortion according to the world. All of these things that are according to the world, it is their right, but it's not righteous. And this is where the big conflict is. And this is where the big conflict is with individuals, even in the body of Christ. They're looking at what's right and not what's righteous. And when people begin to look at what's righteous, their life begins to change. That's what he was saying here. He's saying, look, all things are lawful for me, but not all things are what? Helpful. All things are lawful for me, but I won't not be brought under the what? The power of anyway. The deception. See, because that's what the enemy does. He puts you under his power. Because of the arena of right according to the world standard. You know, I remember BC. Unfortunately, in some places, I do still remember BC. And, you know, I used to use this. Well, it's the New Testament. Jesus paid the price for everyone. I can do whatever I want. Wrong. doing whatever I want didn't help. Well, it's a modern day. This is how it is these days. No, Jesus didn't change. He's the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. He's not changed. But man's influence through the demonic forces, technology. Look at the technology. Oh my gosh, it's killing people. Causing separation in families, causing pornography and all the other stuff. You know, okay, so people can go buy magazines because it's a right. At a certain age, you get a right. So you get a right to do more evil. That's what this is, the fight is over right and righteousness. Yes, we have rights. In fact, even the Constitution has it. You know, the Bill of Rights. In fact, that's the First Amendment, first 10 amendments in the Constitution is actually the Bill of Rights. But it doesn't mean that it allows me and you to do something that's unrighteous, even though it's legal. Oh, hallelujah. The law of the unrighteous versus the law of the righteous. This is where we're at. Again, the Constitution, Bill of Rights. And there's the Constitution, the Bill of Rights, and the justice law. There are rights of the people, rights of the government, and are enforced by the government, judged by the government, and executed by the government. Rights of man in the United States, but not all approved by God. Amen? They're not all approved by God. These rights can bring people under bondage because what the world approves, God disapproves. When a person is arrested, like I said, they give us your rights. Amen? Rights may be helpful, but not, or in other words, the rights may be an area where it may be helpful. Amen? I mean, the law may be helpful in certain areas, but then there's that arena where your personal rights, according to the rights according to the government, can be harmful. So these are areas that you must discern in everything that you do. Even though you may have a legal right for something, doesn't mean it's righteousness before God. Amen? And this is the great deception of influence that is affecting the body of Christ right now. The body of Christ is divided in many areas. There are people calling themselves believers, but they're approving of the things that are right standing according to the world, but not right standing according to God. Not at all. 2 Corinthians 6. God is calling his people back to righteousness. Second Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 14. Are you ready? Let's speak it. Do not be what? Unevenly yoked together with what? Unbelievers. For what fellowship has righteousness with lawlessness? And what communion has light with darkness? And what accord has Christ with Belial? And what part of has a believer with an unbeliever? And what agreement has the temple of God with idols? For you are the temple of the living God, as God has said, I will dwell in them. I will walk among them. I'll be their God, and they shall be my people. If they do what? If they come out from among them. In other words, come out from the things that are right according to the worldliness. And come into a place of righteousness. See, that area of right with many people has an influence agenda of entitlement. It's owed to me. This is my right. But that doesn't sound like denial of self to me. Therefore, come out from among them and be separate, says the Lord, and don't touch what is unclean. Why? Because even though it may seem right, it is unclean. Amen. And I will receive you. And I'll be a father to you, and you shall be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty. That is powerful. Come out from among them, the unrighteous laws that are entitlement rights, and come into the relationship of righteousness, which is right standing and uncompromising the will of God. Right standing and uncompromising the will of God. Again, the rights, there's that right, that versus, it's the world's right of approval and perverseness and lust versus God's righteousness and judgment. In Psalm 15. Now everyone has a free will. You get to choose. But you also get to choose your destiny and an end result. I'd rather have God choose it for me. Psalm 15. So there's got to be training. There's got to be learning. That's why we fellowship. That's why we gather together. This is a training session. This is the manual. This is not some religious Bible study. Amen? This is not about religion. Jesus didn't come to bring religion. He came to bring the truth, a kingdom, and a relationship so that you would know who your true father is. Who that you know your true family is and what kingdom. See, you came from that kingdom already. You came from the presence of God. God sent you here to fulfill a mission. And you should have a desire to fulfill it. But the only way you're going to fulfill it is to deny yourself, your desires and your will. Or you can't fulfill that mission. And it's a terrible thing to stand before God and know that you didn't fulfill the mission that you've been called and sent to do. Can you imagine enter eternity just by the skin of your teeth? But knowing that you didn't fulfill the fullness that God had for you. Amen? Amen? Now believe me, God can catch everything up. You don't have to. See, people get saved and they try to catch up everything. They try to fix their lives and everything. And don't even give God the opportunity to fix it. And you know what they end up doing? Go back in that cycle again. Stumbling over their feet and their tongue. Psalm 15, verse 1. Let's speak it. Lord, who may abide in your tabernacle? That's in his presence. Who may dwell in your holy hill? Are you ready? He who walks what? Uprightly. Who works and works what? Righteousness. In other words, his fruits are righteous. And speaks the truth in his heart. He does not backbite with his tongue, nor does evil to his neighbor, nor does he take up a reproach against his friend, and whose eyes a vile person is despised, but he honors those who what? Fear the Lord. In other words, associations bring impartations, don't they? See, when people come out of order, they hang out with people that are out of order. But when people are in order, they hang out with people that are in order. Until finally the heart gets convicted and says, you know what? I got to stop what I'm doing. This ain't right. Then you say goodbye. I'm done. I got to get right with God. Because if I don't get right with God, I'm not going to have that peace. Because see, the Holy Spirit don't give up on you. Convicts. It's like that little behind the head. You know? Every morning you get up, oh man, I need to get right with God today. You'd be driving all of a sudden. You need to get right with God today. Oh, yeah, I know. Oh, yeah, I'll get there. And finally, it's like, I can't take it any longer. Lord, have mercy upon me. And he does. See, when you say, Lord, have mercy upon me, what you're asking him to do is consider you. Consider me. And I considered you a while ago. I'm just waiting for you to humble yourself. And then what does he do? He releases his grace, which is his plan. Come on back, I got you. And he starts slapping the devils around. Get away from my kid. In whose eyes a vile person is despised, but he honors those who fear the Lord. He swears, he who swears to his own hurt and does not change. In other words, he'd rather take somebody something hurt himself than allow someone else to be hurt. He who does not put out his money at usury, nor does he take a bribe against the innocent. He who does these things shall what? Never be moved. This is phenomenal. This is a guideline right here. It's a complete guideline of defense from evil. This is a complete guideline of defense from evil. Walks uprightly. In other words, you're right standing with God, uncompromising his will. What are you doing? You are producing fruits of righteousness. In Psalm 18. In verse 20. Psalm 18, verse 20. Are you ready? Training for reigning. We want the whole truth and nothing but the truth. It's my right. Verse 20. Are you ready? Can you handle this now? Now don't get offended, okay? The Lord rewarded me according to my what? Oh, snap. He rewarded me according to my what? Righteousness. According to the cleanness of my hands. He has recompensed me. For I have kept the ways of the Lord and have not wickedly departed from my God. For all his judgments were before me. I did not put away his statutes from me. I was also blameless before him, and I kept myself from iniquity. Therefore, the Lord has recompensed me according to my righteousness and according to the cleanness of my hands in his sight. Man, you want to be rewarded by God? You know, when people don't get rewarded by God, they reward themselves. And you know what that happens? It brings trouble. It brings trouble. Every time. Because what you get for yourself, you got to maintain. What God gives you, he maintains. Rewards according to the righteousness and clean hands and a clean tongue. Genesis 15. Hallelujah. Genesis 15. In verse 1, Genesis 15, verse 1. And after these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision, saying, do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield, your exceedingly great reward. But Abram said, Lord God, what will you give me, seeing I go childless, and the heir of my house is Eleazar of Damascus? Then Abram said, look, you have given me no offspring. Indeed, one born in my house is not my heir. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him, saying, this one shall not be your heir, but one who will come from your own body shall be your heir. Then he brought him outside and said, look now toward the heaven and count the stars if you are able to number them. And he said to him, so shall your descendants be. And Abram believed in the Lord, and he accounted it to him for what? Righteousness. What's the word believe mean? To follow. So let me tell you, the word says deny yourself, pick up the cross, which means to fight, and follow. As you follow, you will produce fruits of righteousness. You can't help but produce fruits of righteousness. If you're not following, you won't. If you begin to follow your will, the dictates of your heart instead of the will of God and the heart of the Lord, you will not produce fruits of righteousness. You'll produce fruits of unrighteousness. You'll produce fruits of mistrust, deception, lying, selfishness, greed, manipulation. Those are all areas that the enemy slides in to try to get us off course. Pride. Pride is the number one killer. Amen? Amen. Go to Psalm 11. Rights or righteousness? Psalm 11, starting at verse 1. Is everybody there? Let's speak, because what you speak is what you eat. What you eat is what you become. In the Lord I will put my trust. How can you say to my soul, flee as a bird to your mountain? For look, the wicked bend their bow. They make ready their arrow on the string, that they may shoot secretly at the upright in heart. If the foundations are destroyed, what can the righteous do? The Lord is in his holy temple. The Lord's throne is in heaven. His eyes behold. His eyelids test the sons of men. The Lord tests the righteous. You're going to be tested. But the wicked and the one who loves violence, his soul hates. Upon the wicked he will rain coals, fire and brimstone and burning wind shall be the portion of their cup. For the Lord is righteous. He loves righteousness. His countenance beholds the upright. In other words, his righteousness. He loves righteousness. He is righteous. And his presence upholds the upright, because his presence hangs with the righteous. Everybody got it? So you want to lose God's presence? Stop producing fruits of righteousness. Philippians 1. Now, let's go to Genesis 3 first. Sorry. Genesis 3. Genesis 3:22. Now we know Adam and Eve blew it. We're still paying the price. Hallelujah. And the Lord stepped in the garden and said, everybody out of the pool. Party's over. So when the Lord decided to throw them out, in verse 22, and the Lord God said, behold, the man has become like one of us to know good and evil. And now lest he put out his hand and take also of the tree of life and eat and live forever. Therefore, the Lord God sent him out of the Garden of Eden to till the ground from which he was taken. So he drove out the man, and he placed a cherubim at the east of the Garden of Eden and a flaming sword, which turned every way to guard the way of the tree of life. Now, I want you to grab hold of something, because the tree of life was a representation of Jesus, the Christ, the true tree of life. Amen? So here, the Lord put a flaming sword to protect the tree of life now, so that no one could get to it. Now, he's put that tree of life in me and you and given you the sword of the Spirit to protect the tree of life. Does everybody get it? We are now the garden. We are to produce, because we have the tree of life in me and you, we are to produce fruits of righteousness. But it's our responsibility to protect. It's our responsibility to fight, to keep the enemy away, to keep ourselves clean. It's our responsibility. Why? Because he's given you a free will. And you show your love towards him by keeping yourself clean and unspotted. Is everybody all right? Philippians 1. Hallelujah. You know, for a new believer, one of the hardest things is to say goodbye. It's like getting on a boat and going on a vacation, but you ain't coming back. But see, you know what you're supposed to do, because you have a higher calling. You have a higher purpose. You have a destiny to fulfill and a mission to fulfill. And no one else can fulfill it but you. Only you. So sometimes it's hard to say goodbye. But it doesn't mean you don't say goodbye. Just because it's hard doesn't mean you don't do it. That's where we're constantly letting things go. I finally had to let go of everything. My family, my children, everything. So that God could deal with me. See, he first wants you. Because when he gets you, you get him. And he puts you in a place where you walk heart to heart, hand to hand, and cheek to cheek. And when as you earn his trust, he knows you won't betray him. You won't depart from him. And even when that consideration comes, you won't allow it to get near you. You say no. No. Because you're not saying that you love him. You're in love with him. This is where the love affair is. Does everybody understand it? That's where Daddy wants to get you into a love affair. See, many people might have a relationship, but they don't have a love affair. And in that relationship, they can sway. But in a love affair, you'll never leave. You'll never forsake him. You would rather die than to break that covenant. That's a love affair. Philippians 1. Is everybody okay? Verse 9. Let's speak it. In this I pray that your love may abound still more and more in the knowledge and all discernment, that you may approve the things that are excellent, that you may be sincere and without offense till the day of Christ, being filled with the fruits of righteousness, which are by Jesus Christ to the glory of the praise of God. But I want you to know, brethren, that the things which happened to me have actually turned out for the furtherance of the gospel, so that it has become evident to the whole palace guard and to all the rest that my chains are in Christ. And most of the brethren in the Lord, having become confident by my chains, are much more bold to speak the word without fear. So he became the example, didn't he? He became the example because he was willing to deny himself, even though he was in chains and bound, imprisoned. He still maintained righteous fruits of righteousness. He didn't go out and say, it's my right. He wasn't fighting for his rights. He was fighting for righteousness. And that's how he got freed. Ephesians 4. All over, people protesting it. You know what? They don't even know they're protesting against the will of God. But they're protesting. Because they're protesting for their rights. But they're not protesting for righteousness. Ephesians 4, 17. Glory. Is everybody there? This I say, therefore, and testify in the Lord that you should no longer walk as the rest of the Gentiles walk in the futility of their mind, having their understanding darkened, being alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them, because of the blindness of their heart, who being past feeling have given themselves over to lewdness, to work all uncleanness with greediness. But you've not so learned Christ, if indeed you have heard him and have been taught by him, as the truth is in Jesus, that you put off concerning your what? Former conduct, the old man, which grows corrupt according to the deceitful lusts, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind, that you put on the new man, which was created according to God in what? True righteousness and holiness. You put that on. That means you got to disconnect to take off, so you can put on the new. James 2. Oh, yes. Are you learning something tonight? You know, the Holy Spirit updates us and things that's going on in the spirit realm. Because either people are being attacked with this, or there's an attack getting ready to happen. So that you know. Remember, God always prepares you. If you're hearing. If you're listening, you're just going, yeah, 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 yeah. Yeah. But you ain't getting nothing. And when that attack comes, You start fighting for your rights instead of righteousness. And the enemy comes and steals, kills, and destroys. Steals everything. Then people start blaming people for what happened, and it ain't nothing to do with people. What we bring on ourselves. Amen? James chapter 2 and verse 18. Is everybody there? Let's speak. But someone will say to you, have faith and I have works. Show me your faith without your works, and I'll show you my faith by my works. You believe that there is one God, you do well. Even the demons believe and tremble. But do you want to know, oh foolish man, that faith without works is dead? He's talking about works of righteousness. Was not Abraham, our father, justified by works when he offered Isaac, his son, on the altar? Do you see that faith was working together with his works, and by works faith was made perfect? And the scripture was fulfilled, which says, Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness, and he was called a friend of God. Wow. How many of y'all want to be a friend of God? Amen. Works of righteousness comes by obedience also. Because if you're following, you're obedient. Amen? See, again, people are still fighting for rights or righteousness. They're fighting for their entitlements or the fruits of righteousness. 1 John chapter 3. Thank you, my Lord. 1 John chapter 3 and verse 4. Is everybody there? You know, many people, even at their jobs, and I'm just going to give you an example. When a foreman or a boss is looking at an individual, there's a person that their right is to take a break and lunch. That's their right. But when things need to be done that aren't done yet, the person that it wants to produce fruits of righteousness won't be concerned about their lunch or their break. Does everybody get it? Why? Because they're more concerned in the mission. They know God will provide whatever needs to be provided at some time. But when people are more concerned for their right, well, I got a break, I get this, I got this, instead of, and then things don't get done. Well, the owner in the business looks at that person not as righteousness, but a person of selfishness, because they're fighting for their rights instead of righteousness. Does everybody understand that? See, so where you're working, believe me, your bosses are looking at you. They want to know what you're doing. They want to see where your heart's at. Amen? What are you fighting for? You know, can you imagine the person says, you know, boss, I can skip lunch today to help out. Man, you don't think you'll gain trust from that boss? As long as you're doing the job right. Amen? Now, don't get me wrong. I know sometimes the job is tough. But man, you go that little extra mile, believe me, you get rewarded. You get rewarded. That's what Jesus asked me and you to do. Go that extra mile. Amen? Go that extra mile. See, when people are more concerned, then people are not laboring on to the Lord, then they're laboring on to themselves. Oh man, I get lunch, 5 minutes left. That's it, drop everything, I'm done. Because they're fighting for the right. But when you fight for righteousness, you go the extra mile. It doesn't matter. Because you're laboring unto the Lord, not unto man. Does everybody get this? Amen. And God will reward you. Maybe man won't, but God will. Oh, glory. Are we there yet? Where did I say go? Verse 4? 1 John chapter 3, verse 4, let's speak it. Whoever commits sin also commits lawlessness, and sin is lawlessness. And you know that Jesus was manifested to take away our sins. In him there is no sin. Whoever abides in him does not sin. Whoever sins has neither seen him nor known him. Little children, let no one deceive you. He who practices righteousness is righteous, just as he is righteous. He who sins is of the devil, for the devil has sinned from the beginning. For this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Whoever has been born of God does not sin, for his seed remains in him, and he cannot sin because he has been born of God. He does not let sin reign. Doesn't mean he won't make a mistake. Amen? But you won't break covenant. In this, the children of God and the children of the devil are what? Manifested. Whoever does not practice righteousness is not of God, nor is he who does not love his brother. For this is a message that you heard from the beginning, and that we should love one another, not as Cain, who was of the wicked one, and murdered his brother. And why did he murder his brother? Because his works were evil and his brother's righteous.
Wow.
And I want to close at James chapter 1. James chapter 1. In verse 21. Rights or righteousness? Let's speak it, verse 21. Therefore, lay aside all filthiness and overflow of wickedness, and receive with meekness the implanted word, which is able to save your souls. But be doers of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man observing his natural face in a mirror. For he observes himself, goes away, and immediately forgets what kind of man he was. But he who looks into the perfect law of liberty and continues in it is not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work. This one will be blessed in what he does. If any among you thinks he's religious and doesn't bridle his tongue, but deceives his own heart, this one's religion is useless. Pure and undefiled religion before God and the Father is this, to visit orphans and widows in their trouble and to keep oneself unspotted from the world. To keep oneself unspotted. Why? So that you do not get influenced by corruption and begin to fight for what is right instead of for what is righteous. Amen? Praise God. Father, we thank you for your word. We are honored and blessed. Let the seed that's been empowered in each and every one of us grow and bear fruit for your glory. I remind you of our request tonight that there be strength, healing, deliverance, and freedom, salvation to each and every one. Lord, I pray that you'll visit your people in dreams and visions. Put them on the path of righteousness. Go before them as a consuming fire and snare their enemies. And bless them. Bless them, Lord. Reward them according to their righteousness in Jesus' name. And everybody said amen.
Amen.
Praise God. Be blessed and stay dressed with the glory.